Good evening. Welcome to Film Forum, Atlanta's best movie talk show, where we keep you in touch with the movie industry as well as review the latest films. We're coming to you live on 14th Street. I'm Steve Markos, and with me is the ever-famous Aron Siegel. How you doing tonight, Aron?
I'm doing fine, Steve. How you doing?
Doing all right. We got another great show as usual.
It's a fabulous show tonight. We've got two fabulous films.
Well, what do we have?
Well, tonight, Steve, we've got Sleepless in Seattle, and we've also got The Firm.
All right, that sounds like two winners. And then after that, we'll be giving you our critic's choice this week, our favorite government conspiracy films. Remember, I'll tell you my favorite three. Aron will tell you his. And then we have a special guest. Aaron's in the guest department. Who's coming on tonight?
Well, tonight we have Jessie Maple. She's an independent filmmaker. She'll be on later in the show.
All right, sounds good. So you need to stick around for that. And we got a lot to cover, so let's get started. What do you want to start with?
I'll start with The Firm.
Sounds good. Let's go ahead.
Okay. The Firm is adapted from the John Grisham novel of the same name and stars Tom Cruise as Mitch McDear, a hotshot law student who's accepted an offer from a Memphis law firm. And Mitch discovers that there are attorneys in the firm that are dying mysterious deaths when they want to leave the firm. So he hires a private investigator to find out what's going on and what else happens. Ends up with several different predicaments, and one predicament in particular is a scene that we have tonight where Mitch meets up with the head of security for the law firm, and let's see the scene now.
The FBI wouldn't come after you if they didn't figure they'd get to you. What do you suppose made them think that?
I have no idea.
See, it's my job to have an idea about that. For example, they might know how important your young wife is to you. They might use that.
How?
Avery says last Friday you took the afternoon off. He figures you might have been with another woman.
Why would Avery think...
How do you know you weren't followed? Here's your Abby, one day walking to the mailbox. Anticipating the arrival of her red book, her sharper image catalog. What does she find instead? She finds heartache, Mitch. The death of love and trust. Imagine her one day opening that. Go ahead, take a look.
Okay, that's a scene from The Firm, which opened up today. It's directed by Sidney Pollack and stars Tom Cruise, and that scene has Wilford Brimley in it. It has Hal Holbrook, Gene Hackman.
A lot of big stars.
Jean Triplehorn, you might recognize from Basic Instinct. She played Michael Douglas's therapist.
Yeah.
She plays Tom Cruise's wife. There was a lot of controversy about who was going to play his wife, whether it was going to be Nicole Kidman or whether it was going to be Jean Triplehorn.
Yeah. I thought the movie was a good movie, but it's going to suffer from the much hype syndrome. In other words, it's going to be hard to live up to expectations. And I went in, and it was a little disappointing. It was still a good film, but it was a little disappointing because I expected so much out of it. And you got to expect that from films that they build up like The Firm. That's what I think is usually the instance that happens.
Had you read the book?
No, I have not read the book. So have you?
No, I haven't read the book either. But from what I understand from some people that have read the book, they say that the film follows about 40% of the book.
Yeah. Everyone seems to, I came out of the theater and people say, I wish they hadn't changed the book. So I don't know what the changes are, but people are upset. What you'll hear tonight is two opinions of guys who are not biased by the book. Like I said, I thought it was a good book. The first hour of the movie seems good film. The first hour of the movie seems to be a little slow. It never gets boring because they kind of prod you along with just enough clues that something is up to keep you interested. But in the morning paper today, I was reading in the Constitution, they said the first hour was good and then the movie got
flabby.
Less. But I think it's the other way around. I think the movie starts off slow and gets a lot better as it goes.
I think the film just builds tension through the entire film.
Well, there's two things I really like about this. Number one, you put yourself into the Tom Cruise character. The whole movie, all I'm thinking about is how in the world would I get out of this situation?
Exactly.
I love that in films because he's faced with... The FBI comes to him to say, look, turn your firm buddies in, or when we eventually take them down, you're going to jail too. So he's faced with going to jail eventually or having the mafia after him.
And he's got a brother that's in jail that's going to stay in jail if he doesn't turn these
people. So it's a no-win situation, and you wonder how in the world he's going to get out of it. And I also liked the fact that this movie does not rely on the typical slasher type ending that all these movies where there's a character that tries to outwit everybody, which Tom Cruise is trying to get out of the situation so that he doesn't go to jail and that he doesn't get killed by the mafia. And usually, like when we saw Guilty of Sin, it was a similar movie, but at the end, that they end the movie with the bad guy getting killed instead of sticking with the mental aspect of the film. The Firm sticks with that mental aspect. He takes everyone down by outwitting them. There's no violence. Okay. They don't have to resort
so
to
So what are you
going to
give this film, Steve?
3 stars. Like I said, the beginning was a little slow, but overall it was a great movie, but it suffers from the much tight
syndrome. I'm going to give this film 4 stars.
4 stars? So we're coming out to an even 3, well, not an even 3.5, but a 3.5, and that's a pretty good film on our 4-star system.
Let's go ahead and take our phone call here. Hello, caller.
Did you ever get a script for the Botany movie?
We still haven't gotten that one.
We still haven't gotten it.
Sorry.
Who would you put in it, Stallone or Schwarzenegger?
Who knows?
I'll tell you as soon as I get the script. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So now we'll get on with our next film. This movie came out last Friday, stars Meg Ryan and Tom Hanks. Disturbed by his father's melancholy attitude over a year after his mother's death, young Jonah Baldwin calls up a late-night talk radio show to ask advice for how he can get a new wife for his father. Now, the radio talk show host convinces Jonah to get his dad on the phone, whose dad, who is Sam Baldwin, who's played by Tom Hanks. At first, he does not want to talk, but eventually Sam starts telling his problems to the world on live radio. Afterwards, the radio is bombarded by phone calls from women all over the world that want to meet Sam. And when his address is leaked out, he is bombarded with tons of letters from these women from all over the world. One letter in particular catches the eye of young Jonah, and it's written by Annie Reid, who's played by Meg Ryan. And he becomes determined to somehow get his father and Annie together because he wants Annie for his new mother. The only problem is that Jonah and Sam live in Seattle, and Annie lives on the other side of the world. Let's take a look at a scene here where Jonah has called the late-night radio talk show.
Yeah?
There's someone on the phone for you. His name's Sam.
Sam, if you've just tuned in, this is Dr. Marcia Fieldstone. And tonight's topic is your wishes and dreams.
Yeah, I got it.
And we're on the line now with someone from Seattle.
Hello.
Hello, Sam. This is Dr. Marcia Fieldstone on Network America.
Okay, what are you selling tonight? Is it the micro hibachis or the Ginza knives?
No, I'm not selling anything. I just want to help. I want you to know that your son called, and he asked me for some advice on how you might find a new wife.
Who is this?
Dr. Marcia Fieldstone of Network America, and you are on the air.
You called a radio station?
Sam, are you with me?
Yeah, yes.
Your son Field.
All right, and that's a clip from Sleepless in Seattle, which came out last week, which is doing quite well at the box office, which I'm getting a little ahead of myself. Aron, what did you think of the film?
I thought it was great.
Did you?
It was absolutely fabulous. It was really an enjoyable film. It was written and directed by Nora Ephron.
Mm-hmm. She's the same person who co-wrote When Harry Met Sally, which
and,
also starred
And This
Meg
Is
Ryan.
My Life. When Harry Met Sally was like a tribute to Woody Allen, and I would say that this film is very similar in that kind of context because the relationships in this film are very real, and the script writing is excellent.
Yeah, the first impression I got from this film is that women are going to love this movie. I think men will like it too, but not as much as women, and I don't think that it's another one of Steve's macho comments. Because I have a quote from Nora Ephron who said she's trying to make an emotional movie that a man won't mind horribly going to see, and Tom Hanks calls it a chicks movie. So I'm not off base by saying that it's more a women's movie. It's directed by a woman, and it's a true romance. And that's why I say women tend to like those more, and men as well will like the film.
And it also draws off An Affair to Remember,
the
Cary Grant film.
It's a slower-paced movie, but when I say slow-paced, it's not boring. Boring means it was trying to be exciting, and it was boring. Slow-paced means it's a more of a drama, a lot of dialogue situations. It's a character-driven film. The good thing about the movie is that you like the characters. It's not as much the story as the characters. And particularly, I had a friend who liked the kid. Who was played by Ross Mellanger. Mm-hmm. Mellanger, I don't know how to say his name.
Could be Mellanger.
It was my friend Ty Reynolds on the press box, and he loved those little kids.
Okay.
You see the press box on Tuesday.
So, what do you give this film?
Well, like I said, the majority of the movie, I think, was an average movie, but it had a 4-star ending. I love the ending. I admit I cried, and I had to wait for the credits to roll to dry my eyes before I snuck out of the theater. So if I'm saying 2 stars for most of the movie, 4 stars for the ending, I'm going to go with 2.5, just a little above average. I'm not that happy.
Well, this film did something to me that I haven't had done to me since Steel Magnolias, and what that was work you into getting your eyes all teary-eyed and then get you to laugh at the same time. So I'm going to give this film 3.5 stars.
3.5 stars. All right, so we're coming out with an even 3 stars. That's better than average, but not excellent on the 4-star system. So
this is a good date movie.
Yeah, oh, definitely. There's nothing offensive as far as sex, violence, profanity. It's a good movie for everybody. So
okay.
Now let's get on with the top 10, and we'll talk about how good Sleepless in Seattle did.
All right, we're going to take a look at the top 10. These are the films that you went to see this past weekend. At number 10, Once Upon a Forest, dropping from number 8 in the second week of release. At number 9 is Made in America. Was number 6 last week, but is number 9 now. At number 8 is Guilty as Sin. It falls one notch to fall at number 8.
It's like the failed version of The Firm, if you ask me, because that one goes to the stupid slasher ending.
That sounds, I guarantee you it will not be in the top 10 next week.
Nah, that's falling.
At number 7 is Menace to Society. Falls out of the top 5 after 4 weeks of release. At number 6 is Cliffhanger. It also falls out of the top 5, dropping from number 3. Remaining at number 5 is What's Love Got to Do with It, based on the autobiography of Tina Turner called I, Tina. At number 4 is The Last Action Hero. This is Arnold Schwarzenegger's buddy cop comedy. It drops from number 2. Debuting at number 3 this week is Dennis the Menace, with Walter Matthau and Mason Gamble. At number 2 this week, debuting at number 2 is Sleepless in Seattle, a film we just reviewed.
So it's doing fairly well, passing up Last Action Hero.
Exactly. And at number 1 this week, for the 3rd week in a row, at number 1 is Jurassic Park.
All right,
so
and
it's no surprise.
Yeah, and gone from the top 5, Sliver, which lasted 5 weeks, and it reached number 1 at one point, and also Dave, which lasted 8 weeks, is gone. I read an article in the paper that says the Last Action Hero, the studios are claiming that it will be a bust, that they're going to lose money on it. I don't believe that.
I don't think so either.
No movie is going to lose money with foreign rights, video rights, commercial tie-ins. I heard Burger King, they got $20 million just from them. So there's certain people that will lose money when you sell us rights to a certain portion of the film.
But I don't think the film is going to lose money. It's a great concept, and it's a fun film to go
see. Well, the studio says they're going to lose money on it.
Yeah,
but like I said, eventually you'll get your money
pockets.
Back. You might not make the money you wanted to. All right, okay. Well, let's get on with our Critic's Choice. Like I said, this week is our favorite government conspiracy films. Aron, what's your favorite 3?
Favorite government conspiracy films. Well, the advantage of a conspiracy film is that nobody can really argue with it, because if you argue with it, then if somebody says, oh, that's not a conspiracy, you can say, aha, see? Anyway. My number 3 favorite conspiracy film was the 1992 Oliver Stone film JFK, which starred Kevin Costner. It tells the plot to kill President John F. Kennedy. And enough said about that. My number 2 film came out in 1976, was directed by Alan Pakula, who directed Consenting Adults earlier this year. It was All the President's Men, starred Robert Redford, and was based on the Woodward and Bernstein articles in the Washington Post about President Richard Nixon. And my number 1 film also stars Robert Redford. It's 3 Days of the Condor. It was directed by Sidney Pollack, who happened to be the same director of The Firm that was just released. It involves Robert Redford, who is a researcher for the CIA inside a government office that the office is hit by what they think is are terrorists or intelligence people from another side. And it turns out that it's a conspiracy. Those are my top 3
all
conspiracy
right. That sounds good. I was going to mention on All the President's Men, that was an interesting film to see how they solved the case. It wasn't really about Watergate. It was how they broke the story.
Right.
Very, very good film, also with Dustin Hoffman.
Right.
Best picture nominations all around. That might be my honorable mention, but I'm going to start with number 3. It's called Capricorn 1. Came out in 1978. There's about 3 scripts in this world that I wish I had written, and Capricorn 1 is one of them. It's one of these scripts, if you write it, you know that someone's going to make a movie into it. It has kind of like the 70s cast of O.J. Simpson and Telly Savalas and Karen Black and stuff like that. But don't look at the cast. Back then, those were the big stars. Now you kind of laugh at a cast like that. Great conspiracy movie. It's about the space program is going, the government is looking for reasons to cancel the space program. Any screw up, they're going to cancel it. NASA has a planned flight to Mars, and they find out just before the flight that the life support systems won't work. So instead of canceling the flight, they decide to stage it on a soundstage and make it a big hoax. And everything works off. They fool the whole world that this Mars landing actually took place. However, on reentry, the spaceship burns up, which means the astronauts now can never be seen again, or else the conspiracy will be blown. And, of course, the government wants to kill the astronauts, and they have to escape. Great plot, great story, and it's highlighted by a great aerial photography chase at the end between a biplane and two helicopters. My second favorite, No Way Out, Kevin Costner. This made him the star. It's a great story. Gene Hackman is the Secretary of Defense who's having an affair with a lady who happens to be Kevin Costner's girlfriend. Gene Hackman accidentally kills the girl, so his aide, who's played by Will Patton, this maniacally devoted aide, decides to devise this plot of this hoaxy Russian spy named Yuri did it. And they put Kevin Costner in charge of the investigations, which means it's a race against time because they have this Polaroid negative. You can't see an image of it, but they put it through a computer digital scanner that eventually is going to show up a picture of Kevin Costner. So it's a race against time for him to connect Gene Hackman to the story before he gets busted and blamed on it. Great story. And also, number one, JFK. People judge this movie really based on whether they believe there's a conspiracy or not. That's not fair. This is an excellent film. Technically, it won for best editing. It's put together like a music video. You'll have two people talking, some tense dialogue. They say, I saw so-and-so walk down the street. Bam, you see this black and white shaky camera. It's put together like a music video. Fantastic film. And I went originally and saw this film with my mother, who said, you know, if there was no such person as John F. Kennedy, there's no such person as Lee Harvey Oswald, and you just thought of this as one big fiction story, you've got the best conspiracy plot ever put together. This is a fantastic film. You've got to watch it three or four times to catch everything. Best picture nomination, best director, screenplay, sound, music, and it won for cinematography and editing. Those are my favorite three.
And you can let's catch take them. The phone call.
And remember, when we do a Critic's Choice, those are on video. We recommend you go out and get them. We got a phone call. Caller, you're on the air.
Hello?
Hello.
Yeah.
Listen, I agree with you about JFK and No Way Out.
Yes.
But could you comment on the latent homosexuality in No Way Out, as played by Will Patton's character, and JFK's brains being very unceremoniously strewn about the back of that black Lincoln?
Go ahead.
So what you're saying is that it may put homosexuals in a bad light?
Well, that and the fact that they're not suitable for family viewing by people who believe in God.
I don't know about that. No Way Out has a few scenes of violence. Now, who really cares if someone believes in God? I don't see any connection in that at all. Unless you believe, you know, the homosexuals are bad. But who cares?
Well, I mean, there's also, you know, Thou Shalt Not Kill and stuff like that. So, I mean, it's like the no film would be suitable for family viewing. So
yeah, you know, I don't get the gist of the question there. So, therefore, we shall ignore it.
Okay.
Thanks for calling anyway. All right, let's get on with our video releases. This is what's coming out on video this week. A Few Good Men, which is an excellent film. A lot better than The Firm, I thought. What did you think? Compare?
I like The Firm more.
You like The Firm more than Few Good Men?
Yeah.
Not I. Okay. But we gave The Few Good Men 4 stars unanimously. And also Leap of Faith with Steve Martin. I thought it was a horrible film. You kind of liked it a little
bit. I liked it. I thought it was cute.
I thought it was pointless. On pay-per-view this week, we have Aspen Extreme.
It's an interesting ski film.
Used People, which we gave 2.5 stars. Hard Hunted, which I haven't even heard of. Have you heard of it?
No, I don't think so.
That one must have snuck by us. A River Runs Through It, we gave that 3 stars. And Candyman, 2.5 stars, which is surprisingly a fairly good...
It's a politically correct horror film.
Yeah, and you think the horror film is just going to be a slasher film. It's actually fairly decent.
Okay. Each week on Film Forum, we have a special guest. This week is no different. We have Jessie Maple and her husband, Leroy Patton. They are independent filmmakers, and we'd like to welcome them to the show.
How you doing,
Jessie?
Guys?
How you doing?
Leroy? So what movies do y'all do? What's behind an independent filmmaker? I mean, you're obviously not Ridley Scott making $40 million independents like 1492, so what goes into making smaller budget independent films? What's it take to do that?
Well, it takes hard work, it's determination that you're going to complete the film. You know, you have to go out and you have to raise the money and convince people that you can complete the film. And also, we were able to get grants to make our films. And the format that we've used so far have been 16 millimeter, and now we moving up to 35 millimeter.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you give us an idea of what films that you've done?
Are they more fiction or are they more documentary?
Our first films were documentaries, but the last two films we've done have been fiction. One called Will, and another one called Twice as Nice.
Are they available for people to watch, or? Or how do you get to see these if you're out there listening to
festival?
The show and they want to know how can they watch such movies?
Okay, well, so far our films have been shown on educational television and film festival. The last National Black Film Festival in Atlanta, I filmed with part of the family films that they showed. Mm-hmm. So you can, you know, see them that way. And hopefully in the near future, Twice as Nice will come out in video.
Right. Now, what got you started filmmaking?
What got me started filmmaking? I guess I just went through the whole process of it. I'm known for being the first black union camera woman, and I shot film for CBS for about 2 years in local news, and then after they switched, I was a film person, they switched to videotape. I decided, well, I had made some money, and now I can go out and do my hobby, independent filmmaking.
All right, what's your role in this?
Well, I'm a cinematographer. I usually in control of the images and things on the films that you see, you know. And we work closely together, you know, in that area, you know.
And do you do other films besides working with your wife, or is it?
Yeah, we. I do other films. You know, I work for other independent filmmakers. I work for Warner Brothers, Columbia Pictures, and also some local Atlanta people here who are very good filmmakers that we work with.
Right. We've got a phone call here. Hello, caller. Do you have a question for our guests?
Is that me?
Yes.
I guess too. I'm just a cameraman. I'll plug myself to the cinematographer. I'll do that later. But main question is. I've produced a couple of small projects and have some scripts trying to develop and find that we have everything here, you know, craftspeople, the film, the equipment, actors, and stories, but having a hard time finding the money to get some movies rolling here. I know in Hollywood you can even go to some banks to finance some films. Is there any way of getting the money people in Atlanta active in the...
That's an excellent
question. That's a good
question.
In fact, I was just going to ask that. How do you go about raising money? I mean, who do you approach? What types of people?
Well, you normally approach people who have a history of investing in films. You know, there are people here in Atlanta who fit that mold, you know, which you can contact. But you should try to contact, like, Image or some of the film forums to work out some kind of deal with them where you can have fundraisers, and then through fundraisers, those people who are interested in investing will come to those events and probably invest in your films, you know.
Well, that is a good idea. I need to mention this, is that Image is Atlanta's, or is it Georgia's, local film, independent filmmakers kind of union.
Right.
And we have they have editing facilities over there. They have classes and all sorts of things going on.
Yeah, because this year I taught a class over there in cinematography for them. Yeah, mm-hmm. So it's a very good place to start, you know, okay. If you want to find investors, you know.
Where are these fundraisers? Are they here in town or?
Well, if you're going to shoot the film here and it's going to originate here, I would suggest you do the fundraiser here, you know, but it's not limited here to just here. You know, you can do that anywhere, you know.
Okay, I understand when you brought a clip with you from I brought a scene from Twice as Nice. Can we go ahead and run this scene?
What's it about? You want to tell us real quick? Or?
Yeah, it's about twins, and they are basketball players, and it's their last year in college. And it's about them discovering that they're going to be living separate lives in different situations that happen.
Right. Let's take a look.
Oh, yeah, I forgot to tell you. Raymond called. Raymond who? I haven't seen him in 2 weeks. Well, don't get down now. You've been holding up under the pressure pretty good. You've only got 48 hours to go. 48 hours. Sis, I wouldn't tell anybody else this but you, not even Raymond. I wish I could turn back and quit. You can't. I know. I'm in too deep, and the whole world is watching. But you have another option. Yes!
Okay, that's a scene from Twice as Nice. And
Jesse,
you had
a comment for the caller. Let's make that comment.
For the caller, I just wanted to say, now with the competition with the independent filmmakers, is that you almost, even to get grants, is that you have to complete at least a scene or two to show, even if you're going to raise money or investors, they want to see a scene from your movies. And sometimes you just have to spend your money or go get a job at two jobs at Burger King or McDonald's just to support your movie. I heard a young lady that had a successful film out recently, and she said she got a job just answering the phone because she didn't want to them to know she could do anything else because she wanted to concentrate on her a film just to make money. Mm-hmm. So you really have to shoot a scene on your film if you really seriously want to compete out there for the money.
And have a complete script as well?
Yes.
For people mm-hmm. to read. Mm-hmm. All right. And let's see, what else are there? Independent filmmakers, what's in the future for you? What are you going to work on next?
Well, we have three scripts, a script that my daughter wrote, commercial scripts, because so far my scripts have been non-commercial, but my daughter's written a commercial script. So we have three scripts that we are looking for money. And I've did very well in the grant situation. And so now I want to move out and see if I can really, you know, get some people with money to support my film.
And our projects are going to be shot in Atlanta. We like this area, so we're going to do all our projects here. So that's the scripts that we are considering will be shot here in the Atlanta area.
You ever use other people's scripts, or pretty much the ones you write?
Pretty much the ones that we write ourselves, you know, until we exhaust those, and then we will probably go out and look for other projects.
All right.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks for Jesse, Leroy. Thanks for being on the show.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Interesting.
And we're out of time. Tune in next week on Film Forum, and we'll be reviewing Son-in-Law. Our Critics' Choice will be biographies, autobiographies, bioepics, and our special guest will be Lana Lloyd. That's next week on Film Forum. See you next Wednesday.